sort of live streaming and figuring out the tech and stuff like that as well. I was kind of hoping you could just like comment on the side or something, because like someone wants to test this and like do like a little hi, I hear you, and you know, probably I sound really far away because my microphone is over there, but I think you can hear me because I can kind of hear myself. Okay, well, welcome. I'm gonna play through my album, which was released today through Koch's Records, called Kaigo Kyoku Kyoku. And it is about my experience as a caregiver for my grandmother. I'm just gonna test this out. Hello. What happens if I do that? It's so bizarre because I can look at the live stream and there's like a 10-second delay or something like that between what you see and what I am currently talking about. So that's kind of funny. It's a fun this is a fun experiment. Okay, well, hopefully everything goes smooth. I don't know, you can also probably send me a message or something like that and just be like, hey, it sounds really weird, and I will probably see it on my phone, maybe? But I'm probably going to be running back and forth between that microphone and my live stream. So, for the sake of expediency, I will trust that everything is kind of working hunky-dory. So I'm going to start off with a song called Bare Hallways, which is the first song on my record. And, I'm gonna sort of talk about each song as I go along, you know, and if you don't already know about it, if you do, this might be a little redundant, I do apologize, but I do like to sort of have a little exposition before I perform each song, since there's a lot of sort of story and you know, the concept, at least from the feedback that I've gotten, tends to be better received if I kind of talk about it a little before I perform each song. Yeah, let's try this out. Okay.
So, you can probably hear me a little better now. I'm guessing. I'm going to be like, all my friends and family who are watching this, please continually send me messages through Messenger or text me or something. Just be like, it's working fine. Or, you know, be like, abort, it's all a failure. Because this is my first time doing this. Streaming software is really clunky and really confusing. I don't know. There are definitely people who are pulling it off, but I think it involves buying like a $3,000 box as opposed to just like using free open source software like OBS. Yeah. Anyway. Let's try this out. The first song that I'm going to perform is Bare Hallways. It's going to start off with a hymn sung by my grandmother that my sister recorded. This whole album is about my experience as a caregiver for my grandmother and my uncle. My grandmother had Alzheimer's, and my uncle suffered from terminal prostate cancer. And so I moved into my grandma's house, which coincidentally was also the house I was born in, back in 2016. And I was a caregiver for her for about a year and a half or so, until my family decided that we needed to move her into a home. And then my uncle, at the same time, was also in late stages of cancer, and decided that he wanted to come back and pass away near his family. So he moved into the room that my grandmother's room, also the room that I was born in, and proceeded to sort of live with me for about 6 months until he succumbed to cancer in December 2018. So, you know, it was a pretty intense experience, and I felt that I wanted to kind of document and create, like, a musical archive. I call it a sonic archive of that experience and of the house and all the objects in the house and stuff, because I felt that it would be important to do so.
It's quiet when I talk. Shucks.
Still?
Really? Maybe I need to turn it up a little bit more. Let me see if I can finagle that. 2 seconds. How about now? Does it sound good? Sounds loud enough? We'll see. Yeah, okay, so I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to perform. And yeah, you're going to hear Bare Hallways. There's 8 songs in total on the album, and I'm just going to kind of go through all of them and talk about all of them. And hopefully, you know, I mean, it's kind of hard when there's like a 5-minute delay or something, but I was hoping for some audience participation or something like that. We'll see how this all works. At the very least, I'll be performing my record live in its totality online for the first time, so this will be an interesting experience for us both. All right, without further ado, I'm going to perform Bare Hallways for you.
Through the darkness below me, keep me safe till morning light. Then let my sins be all forgiven, bless the friends I love so well. Take me when I die to heaven. I'm there with you to dwell.
The rogues, the harvest coming in.
In the end.
was the first one. Delay is a fascinating thing. It kind of wasn't something I was really expecting. And streaming live. Because it just kind of adds to that whole isolation and disconnect that I feel kind of happens with live stream. I don't know. I don't really know what the solution is during the pandemic for live performance and stuff like that. If you can tell, it feels wholly dissatisfying to me right now. I'm just kind of performing to myself and talking at a computer screen. Anyway. Okay, so the next one is called Blue Eyed Doll. It was the first single that was released on my album. When my grandmother was moved into the elder care facility, I would go and visit her every once in a while. And every Thursday, she would participate in this group choir made up of volunteer Japanese ladies who would come, and they would sing classic Japanese folk songs, things that people in the elder care facility would recognize or remember. This particular one, Witchwood Towers, actually had a large population of elderly Japanese people who came there, and so they kind of, we felt that bringing my grandmother there would kind of help keep her active and connected and spark her memory a bit if she was sort of switching between English and Japanese as well. So while we were all sort of singing together, I took my cell phone and recorded some of the songs, and this one in particular came out quite well, so I felt that it would be nice to turn a song out of the folk song, which in Japanese is called Aoime no Ningyo and directly translates to Blue-Eyed Doll. So I just took the actual name of the folk song, called it Blue-Eyed Doll, but it is my own song based off of the folk song. Back in 2019, I toured a lot with the band that I was in, Yamantaka Sonic Titan. A lot of touring can be really brutal, so you'll play a show at midnight, kind of finish up at like 3 a.m. or something like that, go to a hotel, fall asleep for 2-3 hours, wake up, and then play another show the next day. So in this particular instance, we had played Edmonton, did the thing, went to bed at 3, knew that we had to get up for like a 7 a.m. flight to Northwest Territories, managed to get onto the plane and get there, and at around 9 a.m. in Northwest Territories, I got a message from my mother that my grandmother had passed away. So this song is also kind of about that experience and grieving, but also exploring gratitude and trying to sort of find gratitude from this experience of being a caregiver and the things that I learned from my grandmother and from caring for her. Okay, so Blue-Eyed Doll. I saw your face. Smiling as I keep it close to know what we went through. Getting off the plane, I saw the truth. And the grief comes.
waves. I can feel it breaking the same old blue at all, ripping the same old blue at all, shedding the same old blue at all, sharing the same old blue at all. 10 o'clock and the buttons of my fear. Only what it takes to make an old scar disappear. Learning grace as hunger fades away. And I know that you've opened closed eyes. Now you're breaking the same old blue at all, ripping the same old blue at all, shedding the
okay. Did I mention it's been a very long time since I performed these songs in front of an audience? Right, okay. So moving along here. Let's see what what's the audience report from 5 minutes ago? Looks good, sounds good. Okay. I'm going to keep assuming that it sounds good and move forward. Okay, so next one is Inori. Technically on the album, kind of for practical purposes, I took the intro of Inori and kind of made it its own thing. The intro that I'm about to perform for you is based off of a hymn that I found in a book of hymns in my grandmother's bookshelf, one of the many bookshelves that she had. She was a hoarder. She held on to everything.
And so this old, old book of Japanese Christian hymns that I found, I found it so fascinating. And I found this one particular hymn, Inori, which means prayer in Japanese, and I just thought it was so haunting and you know, unusually somber for a hymn that I really took to it and wanted to sort of build a song out of that. So the beginning, what is called Inori intro on the album, and what I'm just sort of going to perform at the beginning, and it's going to go seamlessly into the actual sort of waltzy, folky song that I call Inori as well, is essentially me overdubbing my vocals into four parts, singing the hymn, and then kind of intersplicing it with weird sounds. I like to perform like this Buddhist mantra, Nammyo Renge-kyo, as well, sort of in between to create this kind of dichotomy between, you know, the two sort of cultural forces that I guess exist within me in a way. After that, I'll play the actual song Inori, which is about, I guess, my experience of caregiving and feeling helpless and really, you know, not sure how to proceed, or, you know, whether I'm even doing a good job, or, you know, all these doubts and this confusion and this feeling of wanting to hold things together, a sense of desperation, you know, that comes from being a caregiver often. You know, I had to call the ambulance for my grandmother a few times, and it was a really terrifying experience, and you feel really out of control and concerned. And so, you know, the song was kind of born out of that feeling of out of control, that feeling of desperation, and sort of wanting to almost engage in prayer as a way of coping.
Namyo Renge-kyo, 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 Namyo Ren
the soot all the way through. I'll wash it all away. Wash it all, I'm frightened. She's dying, but if I make the call, they'll take it all away. If I break, they'll just take it all. My partner was joking that we would get like a clap track or something like that, pre-designed, pre-installed for me or something. I'm kind of wishing that that was the case, actually. It'd be nice to have like some sort of like, oh, okay, I'm not just in a basement by myself, playing to absolutely no one. There are so many people that I have to just constantly be thankful for. He really made this album what it was. I do have an acknowledgement section. I'm not going to try and, you know, mention every single person who contributed. There's so many, and I'm going to forget at least someone. But it, you know, this is the milk of human kindness, this album. I think when I sort of started talking about this idea and mentioning to people, people really came out of the woodwork. And I think that's kind of a testament to the strength of this project, or sort of what, you know, I was hoping to accomplish, which is to connect people and to talk about something that was really vulnerable. I think, especially at this point in time, you know, with the world events and stuff like that, it's particularly poignant to look inwards and to see what we can learn about ourselves. And I definitely use music to do that for myself. Yeah, this was definitely a way to sort of explore the things that I went through and to find some sort of catharsis and to make something really meaningful out of that. So I think I feel strongly that I managed to accomplish something similar to that. And so I'm really thankful for everyone who helped me out and made this project what it was, because it couldn't have been without, you know, everyone else to make this thing. So the next one is Snowdrops. Within Snowdrops, I'm going to start off singing a song you may recognize, Sakura, which is a classic Japanese folk song. My grandma sang it often, and it was one of the few sort of folk songs that she remembered up until the sort of the really late stages of her Alzheimer's, when she was already in the elder care facility. You know, when I started taking a microphone around the house and just recording all these various objects, so many things that I had taken for granted as a child became so much more meaningful. The sound of the cuckoo clock that is in this song, and the sounds, the various sort of clicky-clacky sounds, this toy, xylophone, just all these things that kind of appear, and you know, it's almost like they come into sharp focus, like the entire time they've kind of just been blurry, and then all of a sudden, you know, this thing becomes so meaningful because you know that it's going to be lost soon, really. That you're no longer going to be able to look at it in the same place, in the same way that you had for multiple decades. And so I'm really glad that I got to sort of preserve these songs, these sounds, and put them into this album this way, because it does kind of, every time I listen to them, I sort of smile, and I immediately, you know, I'm met with this image of like the cuckoo clock that was in my grandmother's kitchen, you know, for so long. And when I was a kid, I used to pull on the chains and kind of like mess with it all and stuff like that. My uncle was, you know, we weren't that close before he had moved in, but we became very close. And sort of seeing him in those final stages was incredibly powerful, to see what he was going through, and how he also worked through them, the stages by himself. I found this poem by Tony Hoagland, who was a poet. He actually passed away from pancreatic cancer when he was 65. My uncle passed away from prostate cancer when he was 65 as well. And this poem is just a really beautiful way of sort of experiencing terminal illness and trying to sort of find grace within it. And I think Tony Hoagland really captured that in such a remarkably beautiful and poignant way. And so I dedicate this poem to my Uncle Brian every time I read it, because I, you know, I think of him and just the experience and the way forward, when you know that the way forward is really just for everything to end. Play this song for you.
Thank you. should I ask you? What's your name?
My name is Kathleen Goring.
And how many kids do you have?
Five.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in Takada, Japan.
What's Takada like?
Takada is very hot in the summer. It's near the sea, but still very hot. And a lot of, I guess, moisture. So it's a sort of hot heat that really makes you feel hot.
Yeah, and there's no air conditioning in those days.
No. But I don't think we worried about such things as the heat.
No, what did you do when it was hot?
Well, we were kids, so we just kept on doing what we were doing.
Yeah, kids sometimes don't notice the heat. What is your favorite holiday?
My favorite holiday? Oh, it must be Christmas.
Why is it Christmas?
Well, I guess it's more excitement and more people around than any other time of the year.
That's true. Is there a Christmas that stands out to you from your childhood?
I think Christmas was always something that I looked forward to and loved remembering afterwards. In those days, we had a real tree and little candles, real candles. Mm-hmm. They got put on the night before, all set. And then in the morning, they were lit. And then they were put up very quickly. We'd had a good look at the tree, and then everything else went on after that.
Do you remember any Christmas presents you used to get?
I expect they were mostly useful things like slippers and mittens and hats and scarves.
Yeah, were they usually handmade?
Of course. Mm-hmm. My mother was a good knitter. And,
yeah.
Solar systems, delicate beyond your comprehension. The dark gold buttons with the purple manes, the swan white throats splashed with radish colored flecks, the thread like stalks that end in asterisks. There, where you left them by the bus stop bench, along the chain link fence behind the widow's house. And you shall squat down on your heels and gaze at them just as you did before, because this restitution of your heart is coming. You need not fear the indignities of death and growing old. The synagogue of Weedhead will be your evidence that every moment is not trampled by the march of all the rest. isolated and alone, pulling the trigger of the morphine feed repeatedly. It doesn't matter if you die, whimpering into the railing of the hospital bed, refusing to see visitors, smelling your own body in the dawn. The dark ending does not cancel out the brightness of the middle. Your day of greatest joy cannot be dimmed by any shame.
Yep, my favorite place.
Your garden. What's growing in your garden right now?
Many little, small flowers.
Like what?
Well, now let me look around and see what do I have here.
You were really excited when the snowdrops came
out. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I love the snowdrops. They're so early.
I know.
And do you know that every little snowdrop has a drop of peach in its little bulb, just enough to make it able to push through the frozen ground? Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
It's absolutely.
Two more songs. How's everyone from 5 minutes ago? How y'all doing? So the next song is called Utopia, and it is kind of, you know, it's the last song on the album, and it's sort of my opportunity to muse or kind of philosophize about death and the afterlife and, you know, the meaning of religion. Obviously Christianity and religion play a huge part throughout this album. But, you know, I'm not necessarily, I don't really believe in heaven or sort of any sort of afterlife. I think this is it, this is what we have, and we have to make the best of it. And I suppose my exploration of faith to that extent, to the point where I sort of feel comfortable, and to me it's still meaningful, is a faith in our bodies, that our bodies reward us towards the end of our lives. And so the song is kind of a send-off, and it's a celebration of our experience in our life and our bodies, and the hope that within those last few moments our bodies reward us with the memories of joy and of profound meaning that we experience, you know, in small moments throughout our life, and that those details are the things that we remember at the very end of our lives. And it sort of goes into the idea of utopia and, you know, whether utopia is even a real thing or not, or a possible or an obtainable thing, you know, sort of by virtue of utopia in and of itself. It's an illusory concept, it's a chimerical thing, and so I wanted to say that utopian experiences were something that was temporal, something you could experience in the moment. So yeah, without further ado, I will perform Utopia. I also want to make a shout out to this excellent backing track, which was done by Amy Catherine Ford. Amazing musicians who participated, Matthew Bailey, my producer, Zainab Wilson, Michael Eckert,
Tara Kanangara, Brennan Swanson, and my aunt Jacqueline, who actually does a rendition of Let All Mortal Flesh Keep Silence on the album itself. It's a solo harp rendition, and it is absolutely beautiful, as well as she lends some nice glissando and pretty arpeggios and things on Utopia as well. So you'll hear that in the backing track. Well, this is my last song. Thank you so much to everyone who tuned in. I have absolutely no idea how many people are currently tuning into this feed. I wonder if I can figure that out. Is there like comments or something? Am I just like, everyone's like, turn it down? What's happening? What is even happening? Figured it would be like really simple and you would just have this like active screen, like kind of like Twitch, you know, where you just have the comments and stuff like that. Maybe I should do Twitch next time. Perhaps this is a lesson learned. Oh, look at all these. Look at that. That's great. 19 people. Cool. Thanks, everyone. Oh, that's so sweet. Thank you for tuning in to my first official live stream, album launch live stream. I wish it could have just been at a venue with amazing sound, surrounded by all my friends and family. That's a shame. but you know, I'm glad that I got to perform this material and that some of you are able to share this with me. The last song is Eternal Host. I sort of took this really home sweet home, which is an old Christian hymn, and I took the chords and I created this really crunchy guitar thing out of it. It's just like sort of sludgy chords at the beginning, and kind of talked in sort of more detail about kind of the challenges and how exhausting caregiving is. Sort of Eternal Host harkens to that idea of like the Sisyphean task of being a caregiver, and you know, the feeling that you'll never sort of, it never really ends, and there's always like more chores or more concerns or more doctor visits, or you know, there's always more to do. And of course, you know that they're never going to get better, you know. Thank you very much for everyone who tuned in. And I hope you have a good evening. Well, I guess I can say that, like, it's not like a show where it's like you play the song and you're like, okay, I'm tuning out. I still have to, like, go over and click stop streaming and stuff like that. So, next song is Eternal Host. I'm going to take a sip of water.
Eternal Host.
go on. I must go on and roll little stones. Can't leave them behind. Nothing left to give. There's nothing left to give. Thank you so much for tuning in. This has definitely been an experience. I wish you were actually here all in front of me, but here we are doing the safest and the best thing that we can do with the circumstances that we have been dealt. Please check out the album. You can go to my website, hirokikyoku.com, or all the social media channels, whatever your preference. I'm on there. And take a listen to the album. Feel free to send me your thoughts and stuff like that. I would love to chat and connect as well. All right, thanks.